After 4 decades, there's a reason that Star Wars A New Hope, or as it was known in 1977 as merely Star Wars, is still a well-known and highly acclaimed movie. I'm here to make my case that Star Wars isn't just a classic film, but a revolutionary one. A new term was gracing cinema, and that was the blockbuster. Recently, Jaws in 1975 had caused a splash on cinemas, as people swarmed them in unnaturally high amounts and caused an astounding roughly $475,000 in the box office. This success was never seen before. With such a success, and the new term coined as the blockbuster, people were wondering what would be the next film that would take the blockbuster title. I think everyone was surprised it was a risky sci-fi film that by all accounts shouldn't have succeeded. But how did it succeed? And who made it? That would be George Lucas, who after the success of American Graffiti, fully funded the film all by himself, which is something that not many people did at the time, as most relied on Hollywood. This was his sci-fi story that he always wanted to make, and he was going to make it his own, despite not even feeling confident it would be a success financially. While George Lucas is known for his creative ideas, he struggled on dialogue, relying on the actors in that department. The early screens had massive tone problems, and the film was considered saved in the edit. Despite all these issues, the team pushed forward to create a film that would be revolutionary. Compared to modern audiences who can thoroughly research films before viewing it, audiences of the late 70s had a very different way of engaging with films. So how did it get so popular? Well, it probably went a little something like this.
Oh, I'm at the cinemas. I've got some money to spare. I wonder what movie I should see. Star Wars. Now that's got a good looking poster. I think I'll see that one. Wow, that was amazing. I need to tell everyone.
Oh, I was thinking of going to the cinemas. What movie should I watch?
You should definitely watch Star Wars. I saw it and it was really good. So you should go to the cinemas to see that one, 100%.
Within a short time, word spread and Star Wars became the next massive blockbuster. Yet the positive word of mouth could only come from a good film. For those who have not seen Star Wars, I would highly recommend watching it now, as I'm going to go through its internally memorable plot. The film starts with a great hook of a ship being boarded and an evil villain being introduced, a princess captured, and two droids escape with the Death Star plans. It's a simple conflict, but one that immerses audiences immediately. To avoid overcomplication, there are only two storylines, the villain's perspective and the hero's. The perspective doesn't shift to protagonist Luke Skywalker until the droids meet him, maintaining a linear story. We learn Luke's dreams of moving beyond farm life, and a call to adventure from Obi-Wan Kenobi promises to train him as a Jedi. Once Luke's aunt and uncle die, he is forced into adventure. Befriending more people and traveling to the rebellion, things are upheaved when they discover
that's no moon, it's a space station.
And they must escape the space station that is the Death Star. For an emotional loss, Obi-Wan is killed as they escaped. Afterwards, the team prepares for a final battle as the rebellion gets the Death Star plans and readies their attack before the base is destroyed. Luke, using the Force, destroys the Death Star and saves everyone. As you can see, it's a classic story that follows the three-act structure quite closely, with an inciting incident, midpoint twist, final battle, and the conventional death of a mentor. When I say revolutionary, I don't mean Star Wars invented these story conventions, but they perfected and popularized it, becoming a clear example to explain the three-act structure. While I glossed over the story, I missed some key parts of George Lucas's style. The sci-fi ships, the Jedi and Sith, mystical powers, lightsabers, iconic planets, all these things develop an instantly recognizable world. There's a reason sci-fi stories can't replicate Star Wars, as it is iconic beyond majority of contemporary media, which is arguably proven all the more through the Disney trilogy that struggles to make new ideas. Those new movies fail to capture the many revolving parts, of which there are many.
Yo, DJ, lay down some beats. What is this track? Play some real music.
John Williams' music is a staple of Star Wars, as the music is not just a background to the story, but a feature that conveys the tone and story. Take George Lucas's favorite scene, for example, Binary Sunset. No voice lines are required, as the visuals and music carry the emotion, perfectly articulating Luke's wishes for a life beyond the one that he has. The music wasn't the only media code that was used exceptionally, but the mise-en-scene as well, which is undeniably revolutionary. George Lucas had recently founded Industrial Light and Magic, or ILM for short, which made great advancements in VFX for Star Wars and still pioneers the film industry to this day. This is in complete display in the Mos Eisley Cantina scene. The costuming of aliens is unlike anything seen in movies at the time. With such an alien environment, audiences gravitated to Luke's point of view, as he is also unsure how to interact with the cantina. Along with the agitated residents of the cantina, the lighting is also darkened, indicative of the sketchy quality the cantina has. Everything comes together to form an iconic scene. In terms of representation, the original Star Wars movie was one of the earliest movies to challenge the predominant gender stereotypes of the time. This is done through subversion, as the characters including Luke and Han perceive Princess Leia as a damsel in distress to save. The preconception is upheaved when, upon being freed, Leia takes immediate control of the situation, bossing everyone around, remarking against them, and making quick decisions. Her independence is presented as a great quality, inspiring women of the time as one of the first steps of strong women in media. Star Wars presents clear messaging as it promotes the rebellion against the Empire, which clearly parallels Germany from World War II. The stormtroopers all wear the same uniform. The Senate is upheaved by a single emperor. And the Empire is no stranger to heinous acts of genocide. By making the troopers faceless, the audience shares no sympathy to them, siding with the main characters and their crusade to defeat the evil Empire. This parallel can also be seen in the TIE fighter dogfights, and is further expanded in the prequels with Palpatine's rise to power. There's a reason fans surrounded cinemas clamoring to view this movie over and over again. It stood out to the crowd with its iconography and style, appealed to audiences with its central narrative, and was visually stunning. It's clear that the revolution Star Wars brought to films is the reason it remains such a staple of pop culture even to this day. Now, thank you for listening to my video essay about Star Wars, and I hope you all have a great day. So from Matt, goodbye!